I'm Tim Tyler, and this is a video which responds to one of Steven Pinker's criticisms of memetics, the one where he points out that memetics features directed mutations. In my book on memetics, which is out now, I take a look at the various criticisms that have been offered of memetics, and Steven Pinker is one of the critics. Pinker expressed a number of objections to memetics in a 2009 Harvard lecture, and here we will look at his claim that memetics features directed mutations. Here is Steven next of all.
If cultural evolution worked in a way that replicated the power of natural selection as a creative force, it would have to work like this. The mutations, the source of variation, would have to be blind, that is, insensitive to the value of the consequences. So you all remember the scene from the Life of Brian in which Jesus gives the Sermon on the Mount and says, "Blessed are the peacemakers," and some guy in the back mishears it as, "Blessed are the cheesemakers." Well, let's say someone misheard him and someone else misheard him, and over the generations, the different variations underwent selection, and at the end of the line, it evolved into one small step for a man, one giant leap for mankind. That's the kind of process that would have to take place. Accumulation of speakos and heroes and typos that led to some product being complex, fit, showing signs of design. And I think we'd all agree that that's really not how cultural change works, and the reason is obvious, that the variants are not typographical variations as they are with mutations of DNA. They are the product of a 10 trillion synapse human brain, which itself is the product of 500 million years of evolutionary R&D. And the situation is very non-analogous to the explanatory burden that we face in biological evolution. In biological evolution, it really is inherent to the Darwinian worldview that there be blind variation, that there be no intelligence in the source of variation. You need this to avoid mysterious processes like teleology and deities with foresight and cosmic engineers and so on. But in the case of cultural evolution, there is no such need. You can invoke a designer with a lot of complexity, namely the human brain, because the process of natural selection gave that to us, and which then is what creates the particular variants that supply the raw material for cultural change. So design without a designer is crucial for biological evolution, but it is perverse for cultural evolution. There really is a designer, the human brain, and there's nothing mystical or mysterious about saying that.
Okay, thanks very much for that, Stephen. It is true that memetics features directed mutations. However, directed mutations are simply not prohibited by evolutionary theory. It is easy to verify this by looking at the definitions of the term evolution in the textbooks on the subject. Not a single one of those definitions makes any mention of mutations being random or undirected. They just talk about variation, and non-random sources of variation are absolutely permitted in evolutionary processes, according to standard definitions of the term evolution in the textbooks on the subject. In the organic evolution of genes, mutations are typically performed inside cells, and they are far from random. The effects of organic mutations are, in fact, biased towards being adaptive compared to what the effects of random mutations would be. This is true because the cell controls how its error detection and correction machinery is deployed. Consequently, cells have a variety of mechanisms to prevent the most damaging kinds of mutations, namely mutations to express genes. Some of these mechanisms have been clearly documented by scientists working in the area, so we know, for example, that some base pair sequences are more prone to trigger mutations than other ones are, and the redundancy in the genetic code allows coding genes to systematically avoid being mutated by steering clear of these mutation-prone sequences. In meme evolution, mutations are typically performed inside brains. Consequently, a much wider array of mutations is available, and mutations can be made using the principles of engineering and intelligent design. So, in memetic evolution, there are indeed intelligent designers, and that is just fine, and it does not represent some kind of a problem. Just because directed mutations exist, that does not mean that natural selection is no longer important, just that it is not the sole star of the show. For example, in the design of a video player, there might be intelligent design involved. However, if you look at the VHS versus Betamax battle, the outcome of that is not the result of an intelligent design process, rather there's a selection process involved. So there is still a substantial role for selection to play in determining the form of the things that we see, and that is why you need evolution as a base theory. Changes by intelligent agents can be modelled as a type of directed mutation, and evolutionary theory is absolutely okay with mutations being directed. That is not forbidden at all. Introducing directed mutation does not gut the theory of natural selection of its explanatory power, nor does it entirely take over the role of explaining the form of things that exist. Directed mutations explain some of the features of the resulting products, and selection explains some of their other features. To explain the observed results, you plainly need a theory that models both selective and mutational processes, and evolutionary biology is that theory. In the case of the VHS versus Betamax battle, the individuals doing the selecting are intelligent agents, namely consumers, but intelligent agents are intimately involved in organic evolution too. Selection by intelligent agents took place throughout human evolution. Human sexual selection was selection of intelligent agents by other intelligent agents. Any idea that organic evolution is somehow blind is just bunk. In organic evolution, mutation may not typically involve very much intelligence, but selection very often does. That does not imply that the selection was done by deities with foresight or cosmic engineers. The selective agents were intelligent humans, and it is perfectly permissible to invoke intelligent agents who influenced the evolutionary process because the process of natural selection gave them to us. This argument allows us to invoke the actions of intelligent agents in organic evolution. It's exactly the same as the argument that allows us to invoke intelligent agents in cultural evolution. The time we are not allowed to invoke intelligent agents in evolution is before intelligence even evolved. However, we have had intelligent agents for millions of years, and they have been influencing the path taken by evolution since they arrived on the scene. Of course, if you bother to unpack the process going on in creating something like a VHS video recorder, you'll find that the process that created it involved a vast amount of trial and error testing. The companies involved in designing them were the result of a trial and error process in the marketplace, based on the results of their previous products. Within the company, there was a selective retention process which was responsible for deciding which engineers were employed by the company in the first place. Another similar process influenced which of the employees worked on the project. More trial and error and selective retention was employed by the engineers involved in attempting to find out what works and what doesn't by using testing procedures. And this was then followed by selective rejection of what didn't work and the perpetuation of what did by supervisors and managers. Also, if you look inside the minds of the human engineers involved, you will find that there's an iterative generate and test process going on in there as well. The mind contains a virtual world which allows possibilities to be tested and rejected rapidly in a virtual environment. The mutations involved at that level are typically generated rapidly and without very much intelligence, and are then filtered by selective processes. Also, at lower levels in the brain, there are still more instances of variation followed by selective retention. For example, in the case of axon tips competing for dendrite attachment points, or dendrite bodies dynamically competing with other dendrites from the same neuron for resources. So you really have a form of natural selection taking place at each level. However, that's really more of a topic for another video. Or, if you prefer, my Memetics book has a whole chapter about processes of selection in the mind and brain, so check it out. Enjoy.